Hello friends, welcome to MOM, the Hindu News Analysis program presented by Deeksha Space. Today in this session we are going to look December 14, 2020 The Hindu newspaper. Before starting today's news analysis, I request all my viewers to please subscribe to our channel and give your valuable feedback to improvise the analysis which is helpful for our UPSC preparation. Today's first article, rare Myristica swamp tree frog found in Thrissur. So this article we are discussing in the context of an arboreal species called Myristica swamp, which is being found in Vasachal forest in 2018. This species is endemic to Western Ghats actually. This Myristica swamp tree frog, which is also known as arboreal species. So in this we will need to know what is this arboreal species. So arboreal locomotion is the locomotion of animals on trees. So this means that Myristica swamp also lives on trees and it has movement over the trees. So this arboreal species, which is endemic to Western Ghats, has got its scientific name as Mercurena myristica palustris. So Mercurena myristica palustris is the scientific name of this species, and it was recorded for the first time in Shankotha Gap in Vasachal Reserve Forest, that is in Thrissur. The same species was first spotted in 2013 in Myristica swamps of Arippa, that is in Kalathupuzha Reserve Forest in western foothills of Agastamalya in Kollam district. So one thing we need to remember here, in 2013 they were spotted in Kollam and now they are being spotted in Thrissur, which shows that the extended distribution of these frogs in Western Ghats have a conservation implication, and they provide a suitable niche for further studies into the diverse amphibians fauna in these ghats. The unique traits of this species are, one, they are rare, elusive, and for the reason being arboreal, they are active only during the breeding seasons. So during breeding season, these Myristica swamps come down from the trees, they breed, and then they go back to the top of the trees. So this article is very important with respect to relevance of UPSC. We can expect a prelims questions from him here. So where do we find Myristica swamp, or where they are endemic in the country, can be a probable prelims question. Next article, slowdown in loans sanctioned to struggling firms. This article we are discussing in the context of slowdown in the loans that are being sanctioned to business and MSMEs over the month of October or November under 3 lakh crore emergency credit guarantee scheme, which was announced by government in the month of May. So here we need to have an understanding of emergency credit line guarantee scheme. Emergency credit line guarantee scheme, which was unveiled as part of government's 20 lakh crore comprehensive package, which was announced on 13th May by Finance Ministry to aid MSMEs in view of economic distress which was caused by COVID-19. Emergency credit line guarantee scheme also provides an additional working capital finance of 20% to the borrower's outstanding credit. The financing is in the form of term loan at concessional interest rates. So these are the highlights of emergency credit line guarantee scheme, which are really important for prelims. In this scheme, there is also an aid which is being provided to non-banking financial companies. There is around 45,000 crores of partial credit guarantee scheme 2.0 to enable non-banking financial companies to help finance housing companies, microfinance institutions, and to undertake fresh lendings to MSMEs. But in this article, as it is seen that the firms are finding difficult to get the loan sanctioned, which has been provided as a relief against COVID-19 struggle which the companies, institutions have been through all this time. With respect to relevance to UPSC about this article, there can be a prelims question about emergency credit line guarantee scheme and the features about emergency credit line guarantee scheme. With respect to mains, there can be a question with respect to measures taken by government in order to promote the industries or recover the economy after COVID-19. Next article, China's moon probe heads back to Earth. This article we are discussing in the context that the China, which launched Chang'e 5, a mission to lunar space on November 24th, and the lander touched on the moon on December 1st. The mission will take around 23 days in total to get back to Earth. If this mission is successful, China will become the third country in the world to retrieve lunar samples after US and Russia. The Chinese spacecraft carrying rocks and soils from the moon has begun its journey back to the Earth, which has put China on the first country to successfully retrieve lunar samples since 1970s. So the successful landing in Inner Mongolia would make China only third country to retrieve these samples after US and Russia. Next article, connectivity infrastructure key points in Modi Hasina summit. This article is important with respect to GS paper 3 of International Relations, India and its neighborhood. So this article today we are discussing in the context of Prime Minister Modi and Sheikh Hasina having to hold a virtual bilateral summit on December 17th. In this summit, there are propositions that there will be discussion over connectivity projects, including a research section of 12 kilometer Chilhati and Haldibhari rail link. So there are discussions with respect to this rail link being inaugurated after 55 years. This was highlighted for this session. The meeting is expected to gain momentum between the bilateral ties of India and Bangladesh after this pandemic, and there were political differences over Citizenship Amendment Act 2. The major issues in this virtual meeting to be discussed were thought of about an agreement of Teesta River, which was finalized in 2011, but still it has been not signed. So historical perspective about Teesta River we will see in detail. Along with that, there are expectations that there will be discussion over water sharing of peninsular rivers between India and Bangladesh. Those are Monu, Muhuri, Khowai, Gomti, Dharla and Dudhkumar. In another video, that is separately, we will discuss all these peninsular rivers between India and Bangladesh, where do they only originate and what are their importance. So about this virtual meeting, it is being proposed that this Chilhati and Haldibari rail link, which is going to be inaugurated after 55 years, it's a British era line, which was abandoned after India-Pakistan war in 1965. And this will be the fifth rail route between Bangladesh and Bengal. So with respect to UPSC prelims point of view, which are the other four rail routes between Bengal and Bangladesh if this Haldibari and Chilhati is the fifth route? So first route is Radhikapur to Biral, second Petrapol to Benapol, third Singabad to Rohanpur, and fourth Gidi to Darsana. These are the four rail routes between Bangladesh and Bangla, and this is the fifth rail route which is going to be inaugurated. And there are discussions over the sixth line of route also, that is Dhaka to Siliguri, which is expected to be flagged off on Bangladesh 50th Independence Day on March 26th. In this virtual summit, there are also expectations that there will be discussion about the friendship pipeline from Siliguri to Bangladesh, Dinjapur, which was agreed upon in 2018 and construction began last week, will also be discussed in this meeting. So this article is very important with respect to relations of India and Bangladesh and what are the steps being taken to take forward this relationship to the new heights. With respect to prelims, these rail lines are very important to have a note. So make a note of this, and this can be an expected question for upcoming prelims examination. About these peninsular rivers, we will discuss in detail in one of the separate video. Let us see a brief background about Teesta River dispute between India, which was finalized or which was concluded talks in 2011. Teesta River, it originates in Sikkim and flows through West Bengal as well as Bangladesh. India claims it has 55% of river waters claim over it or rights over it. However, Bangladesh wants major share of water from Teesta River. Negotiations were there on this dispute from very long time, since 1983. And in 2011, an interim deal was proposed which gave status like India will have rights of 42.5% of Teesta water and Bangladesh will have 37.5% of river water. However, Chief Minister of West Bengal, Mamata Banerjee, opposed this deal and it remained unsigned. In fact, she was supposed to accompany Prime Minister Manmohan Singh to Bangladesh to sign this deal in 2011. However, Bangladesh has been proposing for 50% of Teesta water between December and May every year, because during this season, the flow of water drops drastically and historically this region or the region where many districts of Bangladesh are dependent on it. The river in Bangladesh is fourth largest transboundary river for irrigation and fishing. Teesta floodplains cover 2,750 square kilometers in Bangladesh and about 83% in India and 17% in Bangladesh. However, Banerjee's argument is that Teesta water is important to maintain Kolkata port and fulfill the needs of the farmers. If water is released from Teesta and Farakka barrages to Bangladesh, sacrificing the state interest, then what will West Bengal people will do? However, apart from this, there are also arguments with respect to hydropower projects over Teesta River, which is another point of conflict. There are around 26 projects on the river, mostly in Sikkim, and aimed at producing 50,000 megawatts of energy. So these are two conflicts with respect to Teesta River. However, the deliberations have reached in 2011, but still the deal has not been signed. It is expected that the December 17th virtual summit between Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Sheikh Hasina will give some results with respect to the signing of this agreement. Apart from this, the 55-year-old rail line will be inaugurated, which will be fifth rail line between India and Bangladesh, that is Haldibari and Chilhati. Other four we have discussed, please note them. Next article is the root of the agricultural crisis run deep. As we all know, in the country, there is a farmer crisis which is going on between government and the farmers. As this farmers' protest is against the act which was passed by the government, that was three farm bills in the month of September. The farmers' contention issue is with respect to registration of private traders, levy of taxes on trade outside the agriculture produce market. The government has proposed these amendments which will empower the states to frame rules on these issues. However, the government has also come up with a proposal that there will be access to judiciary for dispute resolution and continuation of MSP. These two changes or proposals which government has put up, even then the farmers have rejected this proposal and they are continuing their demand for complete withdrawal of these acts along with making MSP as a guarantee. In this article, we are going to briefly discuss about how the accumulation of different threads or one thread led to many protests across the country and what are the real challenges farmers are facing in this present context. Structural problems are always there in the agricultural scenario, but how government has to overcome this problem and what are the way forward with respect to that. Let us see here that the protest among farmers is not the new one which is happening now. It has always been, from last 4 years, if you see, first in Tamil Nadu, farmers of Tamil Nadu, they camped in Delhi for over 100 days. Second, Maharashtra witnessed Kisan Long March of farmers, where more than one occasions it happened. In Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, Haryana and Gujarat, Karnataka and Chhattisgarh have also erupted protests of farmers. At least 5 farmers were killed in Madhya Pradesh, Mandasur, about 3 years ago. All these protests are because declining farmers' income, about the wages, that is stagnated wages, and withdrawal of state support of the agriculture. Here, we need to understand, even if the present crisis which is being going on and the government is able to solve it, it is only a temporary solution because the farmers are mainly held up with these problems. That is, declining agricultural income, stagnated wages, and withdrawal of state support of agriculture. So the present crisis which has happened is because of enactment of 3 acts which are affecting agriculture marketing, contract farming and stocking of agricultural producers. The farmers see these acts as to dilute the safeguards which are provided to them and providing an unfair advantage to private sector, raid corporate sector and APMC mandis. These 3 sectors are unlikely to resolve the structural disabilities which were already there in the Indian agriculture. Even though these acts were taken back, that does not give any relief to the agriculture sector. So, the solution lies far ahead of these 3 acts which present crisis is going on. Even if the solution is given to the 3 acts which are being in crisis as of now, that will be a temporary solution for them.
What is the real changing face of agriculture? If we see, that is about remunerative prices for majority of agricultural commodities. What is the changing phase? In changing phase, first thing is about remunerative prices for the agricultural commodities. If you see, there has been sharp increase in the price variability in recent years with respect to crops. For example, the wholesale price index with respect to wheat has been declining from July, and it is negative for last 3 months, that is August, September and October, despite the procurement by the governor. And due to this, in many of the states, wheat is sold at 20 to 40% lower in lower prices as compared to MSP. With respect to paddy also, in many states, the goods are paddy is being sold at lower prices than MSP. Maize for that matter is sold at 40 to 60% lower than MSP. However, if with this act, the state is trying to withdraw the MSPs, how can the farmers rely upon the private traders when the government itself is not ready or not able to ensure procurement for majority of crops of 23 which are already announced into MSP? So with the present vulnerabilities with respect to remuneration, the farmers are at the edge of frustration. What are the factors if we see in detail? Responsible for the vulnerability of farmers, then we have seen that remunerative prices of the agricultural commodities is the one reason. Then next is increased mechanization in agriculture, and third, monetization have led to an increase in the cash requirement for the farmers. As we all know, the cash requirement for the farmers is being met by non-institutional sources. Those are usually middlemen or money lenders who come up with high interest rates. Because of this, there has been increase in the cost of cultivation and increase in loan defaults. Along with this, the demand of loan waiver will not add any input for farmers, because from 2010-11, the nutrient-based subsidy scheme over fertilizers which was implemented has increased the prices of fertilizers. It has not benefited any of the farmers with respect to agriculture production. Along with this, withdrawal of subsidy on diesel, rise in electricity prices has only made life of farmers unviable. Agricultural investments are declining from last 4 years because of government improper policy, and the rising input cost and falling output prices are the reason for decline in investment. Along with this, we need to consider the other end also, that is demonetization and lockdown, which was imposed during pandemic breakdown, has also increased the uncertainty and vulnerability in the agricultural sector on both fronts, that is input and output front. So these are the three major factors which are presently making the life of the farmer vulnerable. So in this article, the author is trying to say about the policy overhaul which is needed for the farmers' structural issues that are present in the agriculture. So there is a need for a comprehensive policy to recognize the new challenges of the agriculture, which is diversifying and getting integrated with the non-agriculture sector. So this needs a better understanding of the issues which are structurally imbibed into the agricultural sector, and need to have an innovating thinking to protect farmers' livelihood from the uncertainty of these changes. Above all, the fiscal support and institutional structure to support agricultural sector is the need of the hour, is what author is trying to say here. So here, with respect to relevance to UPSC, in prelims, there can be a question with respect to nutrient-based subsidy scheme, which again I will make a separate video in order to have a clarity about the scheme, what is it all about. In order to briefly make you understand about this scheme, this nutrient-based subsidy scheme was initiated in the year 2010. Under this, a fixed amount of subsidy was decided on an annual basis to be provided on each grade of subsidized phosphatic and potassic fertilizers, except urea. Urea is not included into nutrient-based subsidy scheme. Please remember this one is very important. This scheme is administered by Department of Fertilizers, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. However, the other important point to be remembered here is Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs has approved the proposal of Department of Fertilizers for continuation of NBS scheme till 2019 and 2020. So along with this, the other futures, why urea is not included in NBS, we will discuss in another video. As of now, for the mains point of article or view, we can have a clear understanding about structural disabilities, what we see in agricultural sector, and what is the way forward and steps need to be taken in order to improvise and remove the vulnerabilities in the agriculture area. Next article is with respect to a sector that needs to be nursed back to health. After COVID-19 pandemic, the role of nurses in universal health coverage has been significant and central. Today, in this article, we are going to read the dimensions about nurses in India. As we all know, year 2020 is considered as International Year of Nurses and the Midwives. And as I said, it is central to achieving universal health coverage in India. With respect to number of nurses in India we see there are around 1.7 nurses per 1,000 population, which is around 43% less than World Health Organization norms. India needs around 2.4 million nurses in order to meet the norms prescribed by World Health Organization. Even though India has around 2/3 of nurse population in India with respect to health workforces. In India, along with low number of nurses as per 1,000 population, the sector is struggling with structural challenges like poor quality of training, inequitable distribution, and non-standardized practices. In this article, we will be taking a look over the challenges and potential solution for the following. Under this article, we will be reading under three headings. One is uneven regulation, second is gaps in education services, and third is bills that could bring up the hope with respect to nursing sector. So first, we will look after uneven regulation in India. Under this, if you see, nursing education in India has got wide array of certification and diploma degree programs for clinical and non-clinical roles. In India, Indian Nursing Council, which regulates nursing education through prescription, inspection, examination and certification, have got various induction requirements which vary widely based on the clinical and non-clinical requirements. The functioning of these regulatory bodies in the states are varying from different state to state. Around 91% of nursing colleges in India are private and they are weakly regulated, which leads to quality of training of nurses being diminished, and due to weak regulation, it is affecting a lot. At current situation, nursing education in India is outdated and need of the hour is to improve the training program or curriculum to develop the needs which are required with respect to present health status. As we all know, education includes retraining also, and it should be given a particular role, and the career progression have to be clearly demarcated so that motivation with respect to nurse community will be always there. In India, we find with respect to post graduation, which is very much essential to develop skills in specialties and to address critical faculty shortages in order to improve the quality and quantity of nurses in India is also lagging a lot of behind. All these factors, education, council, curriculum, post-graduation are the factors which have led to gap in skills and competencies. With no clear career trajectory for nurses, the nurses community are demotivated in order to take their career into this. In order to improvise this sector, multiple entry points to nursing courses have to be integrated with diploma degree courses, where we actually finding a diminishing quality of training. Common entrance examination, national license exit test for practice, and periodical renewal of license will help to improve the nursing education and strengthen the nursing education system in India. Transparent accreditation, benchmarking, ranking of nursing education systems, institutions will also improve the quality. And the last factor is distribution. Distribution of nursing education in India, if you see among the states, is mostly concentrated in southern India, which is around 62%. Even then, the country has tried to improve their performance with respect to post-graduation diploma courses, where around 12 colleges are being established. but due to lack of admission because of higher education qualification is not recognized by recruiters, the students or nurses are not willing to take up post-graduation specialized skill development. In order to improve the performance of the post-graduation, another major requirement is faculty positions in these nursing colleges and schools are around only 86% to 80% unfilled. So these unfilled positions have to be taken care at the earliest in order to challenge or address the solution for post-graduation skill development. Under the second heading, we see gaps in education and services. If you see at this sector, most nurses working in public and private health sectors are diploma holders, and there is no differentiation between diploma, graduate and postgraduate nurses with respect to their pay, parity and promotion. Higher qualification of postgraduate nurses are underutilized, or they are leading to low demand for postgraduate courses, which is actually demotivating for the nurses to pursue post-graduation in order to develop their skills. So, in order to address this, employment in education institutions have been more taken up or migration to abroad, because their qualifications are being recognized, have led to dearth of qualified nurses in India. The compounding problem of nurses in India has led to another major problem, like small private institutions with less than 50 bed recruits candidates without formal nursing education. This shows that the course offered of 3 to 6 months for non-clinical ancillary nursing roles are paid very little and they are underutilized at the present context. The nursing practices in India are unregulated, which is another very important problem. Indian Nursing Act, which primarily revolves around nursing education and does not provide any policy guidelines about their roles and responsibilities in various cadres, is another backstep. Nurses in India have no guidelines in order to their scope of practice, standard of care, which will endanger the patient's safety. Another major reason for the low legitimacy of nursing practices and profession is mismatch of role description and remuneration that benefit the role sets the stage for the exploitation of nurses. That is with respect to Indian Nursing Act. If you see at Consumer Protection Act, which protects the safety and rights of the patients as consumers, holds only doctor and hospital liable for medico-legal issues. Nurses are out of the purview of the act. In contrary, in developed countries, if you see, nurses are legally liable for errors in their mistakes. These forms of institutional reforms can be addressed, or there are three issues which need to be taken care. First, governance of nursing education and practices must be clarified and made current. As we have discussed, Indian Nursing Council Act 1947 must be amended to explicitly state clear norms of service and patient care and fix the nurse to patient ratio, staffing norms and salaries. Second, jurisdiction of Indian Nursing Council and State Nursing Council must be explained and coordinated so that they are synergistic. Third, exodus of qualified nurses must be contained. In India, we can try up a model such as public-private partnership between private nursing schools and colleges and public health facilities, and another strategy to enhance nursing education. Niti Aayog has recently formulated a PPP model in education system in medical services that could be referred as a model agreement for nursing education. The government has also announced supporting such projects through VGF mechanism. Last point of the article, if you see, the disabling environment prevalent in the system has led to low status of nurses in the hierarchy of healthcare professionals. The National Nursing and Midwife, National Nursing and Midwife Commission Bill, which is currently under consideration, is hopeful that it will look after the issues and challenges which we have discussed in the above scenarios. Next article, hazardous ideas for the Himalayas. This article we are discussing in the context of an article published on the website of Central Committee of Communist Youth League. China announced that it is planning to build a major hydroelectric power project under its 14th five-year plan, that is from 2021 to 25, on Yarlung Zhangpo River in Medong County in Tibet. The hydropower generation station is expected to provide around 300 billion kilowatts of electricity. The Chinese authorities claim it could help them to realize a goal of carbon emission peak before 2030 and carbon neutrality by 2060. However, speculations about this project began in Medong County, not far from Arunachal Pradesh. Indian counterpart quickly retaliated their plans of dam at the Himalayan on the side of the border. India reported that it is going to build around 10 gigawatts hydropower project in the eastern states. At this juncture, we need to understand that there is a misadventure going on between India and Chinese counterpart with respect to building of hydroelectric power projects. How this is a misadventure, we will see in detail at this article. In the mad rush, both countries ignore how unviable these super dams will cause to the Himalayan region. The geologically unstable, the region where these projects are being planned are under massive earthquakes, and there are chances that it will happen in the near future also. Over the past 20 years, if you see, India and China have been competing to build hydroelectric power projects in this ecologically fragile and seismically vulnerable area. There are two hydroelectric projects which India has come up. This is very important to remember, in Arunachal Pradesh on the tributaries of Brahmaputra. Those are 600 megawatts Kaming project on Bichom and Tenga River. The other one is 2000 megawatts Subanasri Lower Hydroelectric Project. So two projects which India is being coming up. On the other side, China has already completed around 11 out of 55 projects that has been planned in the Tibetan region. If you look at these hydroelectric projects which are being planned, are maddening pace, which shows that the two countries overestimate their economic potential and grossly underestimate the economic vulnerability of this region. Higher seismic zone coinciding with the areas of higher population concentration in the Himalayan region, leading to landslides and glacial lake outwards floods, are common in this region. About 15% of earthquakes in the 20th century have happened in Himalayan region. The northeastern Himalaya has experienced several large earthquakes of magnitude 7 and above in the last 100 years. For example, if you see, earthquake of 1950 at McMahon line was around 8.6 magnitude, which led to major devastation in Tibet and Assam. The earthquake killed around thousands of people and led to extensive landslides, widespread land level changes and gaping fissures. Along with this, there is another example of 2015 Gorkha earthquake of the magnitude 7.8 in central Nepal, which also resulted in a huge loss of hydropower sector and nearly 20% of hydropower capacity consequent to the earthquake. About 30 projects were affected because of this, and overall Nepal accumulated a loss of around $200 million. In this article, a study published in 2018 by Geophysical Research Letter shows that it is very important to have an understanding about earthquake borne damage sustained by hydroelectric power projects in Nepal. The main mechanism which contributed to the vulnerability of hydropower projects were found to be landslides, which depended on the intensity of seismic ground shaking and slope gradients. In this region, heavy siltation from giant slides are expected in the project sites, and headwater region from future earthquakes, which will reduce the water holding capacity and life expectancy of such dams. However, here another important section which is being spoken about is under threat. What are under threat as of now? If Himalayan range is a transnational mountain chain, which is a chief driver of Asian climate, and it is source for numerous Asian rivers and glaciers, which are now under the threat of degradation and retreat due to global warming. These river systems provide water for billions of people. The legacy of humanity has now become highly contentious and with territorial disputes between two nuclear nations, India and China. The two nations have to consider the present situation and understand that carbon neutrality should not be at the expenses of the environment. Here, the another important point is, rather than engaging in unsustainable dam building activities, India and China, the major players of this region, are advised to disengage from military adventurism and seek ways of transforming this roof of the world into natural reserve for the sake of humanity. Many of the experts are also saying that this region need to be covered under natural reserve by international agreement in order to promote misadventurism in this region. And with respect to river, Himalayan River Commission can be taken up so that this region remains elusive and the people living in this region can live with prosperity and peace. This is about this article. Next article is with respect to innovations for cleaner air. Over the past 10 years, we have seen India has made a significant progress with respect to air pollution. There are around 250 continuous ambient air quality monitoring stations and around 800 ambient air quality monitoring stations across the country. Owing to these number of stations, the magnitude of challenge of air pollution has not been under control. The tremendous effort in improving awareness among citizens through campaigning around air pollution and its adverse impact on health and environment need to be amplified more in order to address the air pollution issue. It is equally important to have systemic changes at the policy and strategy levels. In this article, we will be looking after the policy and strategy levels which need to have a systemic changes so that we can understand the problem and come to a conclusion how and where it can be solved. In this article, first we will see the welcoming policy interventions which are taken care with respect to air quality promotions. Public policy has been responding positively. As we all know, budget allocation for air pollution was substantially increased in 2020-21 in comparison to 18 and 19 to ensure cleaner population in cities at least having population of 1 million and above. The establishment of Commission of Air Quality Management with penal provisions against the polluters in National Capital Region and adjoining areas is a welcome step. So, increase in budget and Commission for Air Quality Management and removal of diesel buses and promoting e-mobility services is another welcome step. And the fourth one is changeover from BS4 to BS6. And fifth one, Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana, under which the efforts are made to reduce indoor air pollution in rural areas by increasing LPG cover. If you all see this, these measures which are being taken are on the positive side, but these efforts will give results only in long term. And India needs to innovate things in order to promise of clean air in the immediate future. In that context, if you see, many institutions are come up with developing solutions. For example, Indian Agriculture Research Institute, PUSA, has come up with biodecomposer which reduces the crop residue into manure in 15 to 20 days, which could be a cost-effective alternative to tackle stubble burning problem. Second, United Nations Development Program has started or promoting a startup-led innovation such as filterless retrofit device, which will help in cutting particulate matter at source in industries and vehicles. It is a nature-based solution to amplify air purification through breathing roots technology for improving indoor air quality. In another way, air pollution in India has numerous sources spread across various geographies. Because India spread across north to south, east to west have lot of sources, and environmental regulators with limited capacity and manpower find it difficult to solve the challenge. At this point of juncture, it is very important to look after digital technologies such as geospatial technology and artificial intelligence to upgrade our capacities to identify, monitor, regulate and mitigate air pollution hotspots. Here also, in terms of technology, if you see, For example, Jio Artificial Intelligence Platform for Brooklyn's developed by, again, UNDP in partnership with University of Nottingham is supporting environmental regulators to identify non-compliant brick kilns from the space. With this geo artificial intelligence, we are able to, or we have already mapped around 37,000 brick kilns unit across Indo-Gangetic plain which are not compliant with the procedure. Given the complexity and magnitude of air pollution, India needs a context-specific innovation not only in technology but in economic, social, legal, educational, political and institutional domains. Apart from all this, what has to be done in order to address the air pollution problem in the near future? If that question is asked, then the need of the hour is to enable ecosystem for innovations to address context-specific air pollution challenges. Significant government support is required for enterprises to come up with scalable pollution abatement technologies. Involvement of private sector is the strong potential to develop commercially viable products to combat air pollution and boost innovation ecosystem in India. If one quantifies the impact of intervention that reduces air pollution with healthcare cost, disability adjusted life years or economic cost, it could lead to diversification of funding of sources for the intervention of air pollution which is required. So the need of the hour is the government support, enabling ecosystem and private sector utilization in order to find the near future solutions for the air problem. This article, with respect to relevance of UPSC, we can understand the context of air pollution's problem with respect to health, economically and socially, and how the present government is working with respect to addressing the problem and what is the way forward. We have seen in detail about this article. This was about today's Hindu newspaper, friends. We will meet up with again new session tomorrow. Till then, take care of your health, study well, all the best. Jai Hind.